Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to join us. Today, I will talk about the applied math for machine learning. We know that mathematics is the mother of science, so it's also the mother of machine learning. It's important to learn some basic math. If we can have better understanding of the theories behind the formula, we can gain more insight of machine learning. I will review several important math fields for machine learning. The first is linear algebra. Linear algebra is very important for machine learning because we will convert the data into vectors or matrix or even tensors. So we use linear algebra all the time in machine learning. Therefore, at least you need to know the matrix multiplication. The second field is probability. As we know, machine learning is one kind of statistical learning. So the fundamental theories of machine learning is based on probability. We need to understand the key concepts of probability. The third is calculus. We use gradient descent to optimize, to minimize the loss. Therefore, we need to learn the calculus to know roughly how to calculate the gradient. Finally, we will briefly talk about optimization. In fact, machine learning can be viewed as an optimization problem, which means we need to optimize the objective function. In other words, we want to minimize the loss. The loss is our goal, and the process of minimizing the loss is a process of optimization. But optimization is a complicated field, so we will only briefly talk about how to write an objective function and reformulate your problem as an optimization problem. Now let's review linear algebra. Let's start with the basic elements in linear algebra. The first one is the scalar. Scalar represent real numbers. So scalar is a quantity, a value, usually represent the real numbers. So if you have a number, it's a scalar. The second element is a vector. Vector is actually an array of scalar, but it has two independent properties. A vector is a quantity that has two independent properties, a magnitude and a direction. But in machine learning, especially in computer science, most of the time we just care about the magnitude because we use vector to save a series of values, right? We view array as a vector in linear algebra. So most of the time we care about the magnitude. The third element is matrix. Matrix is an array of numbers arranged in rows and columns. Here's an example of an array. Okay. So you can see that if we have a two-dimension 2D array, right? It's a matrix in linear algebra. But in practice, we usually have more than two-dimension data, or then the data that have more than two dimension is called tensor. So tensor is a multi-dimensional arrays of numbers. Let's see some real-world examples of data tensors. The first example is time series data. Time series data include the temperature or stock or house price or stock price or house price. Basically, the value of the features are changing with time. So why the time series data are three-dimensional? The first dimensional is the number of samples. Stock market as an example. Suppose we want to collect the stock price data and we want to use train a model to predict the stock price. First, we need to collect the feature of a stock. So what's the feature of a stock? The open price, right? Today's open price and the high and low or close price, we can use them as features. Then we will have four features, right? The open price, the high price and the low price and the close price. That's the most common features of a stock. Then we record every day the four features of a stock, right? For maybe 200 or 300 days, or even 1 or 2 years. Then the data becomes two-dimensional data. And we can record multiple, record the price of multiple stocks at the same time, right? So we will have multiple samples. Maybe we can track 100 or 1,000 stocks simultaneously, and then we will have multiple samples. So the time series data become a 3D dimensional 3D tensor. The second example is image. Images are four-dimensional data because one image includes the height, the width, and the channels. So the height width of images is very obvious. So what are channels? Remember, the images we have, usually the images we have are colorful images, right? And colorful images are include three colors for each pixel, red, blue, and green, RGB. Therefore, for colorful images, the images are 4D data, samples, height, width, and channels. Of course, for the grayscale image, it can be a 3D, three-dimensional data, sample, height, and width, but it only have one channel. Okay, the third example is video. Video is a series of images, right? So it's a five-dimensional data. In addition to height, width, and the channels, videos has frames. So here is an example. The images there are multiple images, right? Each image has color channels, height, width, and color channels, and the video consists of multiple images. So it has is a five-dimensional data. Images are four-dimensional data, height, width, color channel, and the samples, and then videos is five-dimensional. We shall call it tensors. So in short, time series data are 3D tensors, image data are 4D tensors, and the video are 5D tensors. Before we continue, we need to clarify two terminologies. One is vector dimension, and the other one is tensor dimension. The dimension we mentioned so far are tensor dimensions. It describes how many different dimension of data we have. For example, a vector is 1D dimension, right? And the matrix is a two-dimension data, and tensor is more than three-dimension. So that the dimension we talk about is tensor dimension. However, the number of data in a vector is also called dimension. So sometimes we use vector dimension to describe the number of data in a vector. So for three-dimension vector, it's actually mentioned a vector that has three data, right, to describe the point in a space. So the 3D vector that we are familiar with is a vector dimension. So to clarify the difference, in deep learning, the dimension of tensor is also called rank. So if you see the word, the terminology rank, it means the tensor dimension. So matrix is a 2D array, and we can also call it a 2D tensor or a rank 2 tensor. So please be careful about the terminology, the difference. Careful about the difference between vector dimension and the tensor dimension. Now let's talk about the matrix. Here is Keanu Reeves, the one in the matrix. Has nothing to do with the metric in linear algebra, but it was a very cool movie, and I encourage you to watch. the old ones. The new sequel is coming this year, but don't expect too much from the sequel of a classic movie. A matrix is a two-dimensional array, or we can say two-dimensional tensor of data. To define a matrix, we can define with the number of rows and the number of columns. Here's the symbol of matrix. Suppose we have a matrix with n rows and n columns, then we can represent a matrix A using the m by n, and it's in the real number. So the data in the matrix are all real numbers. This is called m by n matrix. Let's look at basic matrix operations. The first two operations are addition and subtraction. They are straightforward. Just add the corresponding entries of matrix A and matrix B, or subtract the corresponding entries of matrix A and matrix B. Here are examples. If we add matrix A to matrix B, matrix A is 1, 2, 3, 4, and the matrix B is 5, 6, 7, 8. The result will be 6, 8, 10, 12, right? The A11 add to the B11 is 6, right? And the A12 plus the B12 is 8. And for subtraction, it's the same. A11 minus B11 is minus 4, and A12 minus B12 is minus 4. So this result is 4 of minus 4. Now let's see how to perform matrix multiplication. Suppose we have two matrices, A and B, where A is a m by n matrix and B is a p by q matrix. And then we want to do multiplication. There's one important thing to note. That is, the columns of A must be equal to the rows of B, which means A is equal to P. That's because the multiplication is about multiply the rows of first matrix by the columns of the second matrix. Therefore, the number of columns, the number n must be equal to the number of rows of P in matrix B. Here is the definition of the new entries after the multiplication. So in the new matrix C, which is the product of A matrix A and matrix B, the entry Cij is equal to the ith row of matrix A multiplied by the jth column of matrix B. So n must be equal to P, n and P. Actually, it's a dot product. If we multiply one row vector by a column vector, it's a dot product. Let's see an example. Here's a matrix A and matrix B. Matrix A is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And matrix B is 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So let's do the multiplication of the first entry in matrix C. It is actually 1 times 7 plus 2 times 9, all right, plus 3 multiplied by 11. So it's basically it's the first row of the first matrix multiplied by the first column of the second matrix, and the result is equal to 58. Let's calculate the second entry in matrix C. So it's basically the 1 times 8 plus 2 times 10 plus 3 times 12, and is equal to 64. I will give you 20 seconds to complete the matrix or the rest entries of the matrix. Here is the answer. Please check if your answer is correct or not. Let's see more matrix operation. Here is matrix transpose. The transpose of a matrix is an operation that flips a matrix over its diagonal. Specifically, it switches the row and the column indices of a matrix. So Aji after transpose becomes Aij. It switches the row and the column indices of the matrix by producing another matrix denoted as At, A transpose. So here's the animation. The matrix A, after transpose becomes matrix At, and the row and the column are switched, right? The number of rows and columns are switched. After another transpose is will be back as the original A matrix A. Another matrix operation is dot product. This is a very important operation. Dot product of two vectors become a scalar. So the dot product of two vectors is actually a real number. We can convert two vectors into a real number using dot product. Dot product is sometimes called inner product, but inner product is actually a generalization of the dot product. Here's the notation of dot product. We use a dot to represent dot product. This is why it's called dot product. So the dot product of vector v1 and v2 is v1 dot v2. Or we can use v1 transpose by v2. V1 transpose multiplied by v2 to calculate dot product. Okay, let's see how to calculate a dot product. The dot product is just to calculate the product of each of the elements one by one. Calculate, for example, here is the vector v1, and we start to calculate the dot product. We will multiply the first element v11 in vector 1 to the vector v21 in vector 2, and then we will multiply the v12 to v22. We do it one by one until the end of v1n to v2n. So actually v1 and v2 need to have the same number of elements in a vector. So how can we use the transpose of v1 multiplied by v2 to represent that product? The transpose of v1, right, will become, sorry, the v1 transpose is actually a row vector, right? And if we multiply by the column vector of v2, just do the vector multiplication and it will get a scalar. So the dot product is actually the v1 transpose multiplied by v2. So here you can see that the dot product is the sum of the products of each elements, the corresponding elements in v1 and v2 in the two vectors. So it's now the final sum is a scalar. In fact, matrix multiplication is actually a multiple operations of dot products. For example, if we want to calculate the element zij, right, is actually the dot product of the ith row in x and the jth column in y. It can be best illustrated by draw the two matrix, right, x. Here's a matrix, suppose it's a A by N matrix, and the matrix y is a B by C matrix. Now you can see why multiplication requires the columns of first matrix equals the number of rows in the second matrix, right? Because we are actually doing dot product. So the element zij is actually the dot product of the row vector, ith row vector of x and the jth column vector of y. Here's the geometric definition of dot product. Actually, dot product can be viewed as the magnitude of first vector times the magnitude of second vector times the cosine theta. And the theta is the angle between the vector 1 and the vector 2. So actually, we can use dot product and the magnitude to calculate the theta between two vectors. You may wonder if we have outer product. Yes, we have outer product. Unlike the inner product, the inner product makes two vectors into a scalar. On the contrary, the outer product makes two vectors into a matrix, right? Here is the symbol of outer product, a cross and a circle. So the vector U, outer product with a vector V, will become a matrix, right? And each element is actually the product of the element in the two vectors. So the first element in the vector U is multiplied to all the elements in vector V, right? So the second element is multiplied to, again, to all the elements in matrix N. So the two vectors do not need to have the same numbers of elements. Suppose the vector U has m elements and the vector V has n elements, and the multiplication will produce a matrix A, which is m by n matrix. Here's another notation, the index notation of the outer product. The outer product can be applied in recommendation system to recommend you the products. Here's an example. There's an algorithm called collaborative filtering in recommender system. It means that suppose you have some good friends and the products that your friend likes, your friends like, is more likely that you also like the products. Right, so it's called collaborative filtering. It's not necessary you're afraid that the system will find someone which have similar habits or behaviors like you and recommend what they like to you. This is called collaborative filtering. Okay, so usually the system will track your preference. So here's an example. Suppose we have a movie website, right? Like IMDb, he's a Harry Potter, right? The Tripolis of Bella Villa, Shrek, or the Dark Knight Rise. So the first user like the Harry Potter and the Shrek and the Dark Knight Rise. And the second user like the Tripolis and the Memento. Those history records and is naturally become a matrix, right? A matrix whose columns are the users. Whose columns are the movies and the rows are the users. So it becomes a matrix. And the matrix can be viewed as the outer product of the human, the user feature vector with the movie feature vector. And then we can do matrix factorization to learn the human feature vector and the movie feature vector. Here's one application of outer product in machine learning. Now let's talk about an important concept called the linear independence. Before we talk about independence, we need to understand what is dependent. Here's the definition. A vector is linearly dependent on other vectors if it can be expressed as a linear combination of other vectors. So on the contrary, a set of vectors v1, v2 to vn is linearly independent if a1 v1 plus a2 v2 plus an vn equals 0 implies that all the scalars ai equal 0. In other words, a set of vectors, the vectors v1, v2 to vn are linearly independent if and only if that they are linear combination. The only solution that their linear combination is equal to 0 is that all the parameters ai are 0. That's called linear independent. Here is an let me show you an example. The standard basis of a coordinate space. Here's a standard matrix, right? Of a 3D space. They are linearly independent, right? Because the linear combination, or the only solution that there, the linear combination of the standard basis vectors is equal to 0, is that all the parameters ai are zeros, so they are linearly independent. Why do we care about the linear independence? This is because vectors can span the vector space. Unlinearly independent vectors can span n-dimensional space. Here's an example. Suppose we have two 2D vector v1 and v2, and we can do any linear combinations by changing the parameter a1 and a2. So by changing a1 and a2, we can combine a new vector v3 or another vector v4. There's a lot of combinations, right? So the old combinations can generate a plane. So this is an example that two linearly independent vectors can span two-dimensional space. We also want to know that how many independent row or column vectors are there in a matrix. This is called rank. So rank is the number of linearly independent row or column vectors in a matrix. If we know the rank of a matrix, we can know the dimension of the vector space generated by the matrix columns. So actually the row rank is equal to column rank. If we want to know the rank of a matrix, we need to do some operation. We need to remove the possible linear combination of other vectors. Here's a method called row enchelon form. Suppose we have a 3x3 matrix A, and we can calculate the row enchelon form. We will first use the first row to remove the second row. For example, we can multiply first row with 2, right, and then add to the second row. Then the second row will become 0, 1, 3, right? And then we can use the new second row. Sorry, we continue to use the first row to remove the third row, right, by multiply by minus 3. So it becomes 0 and minus 1. and minus 3. Then we can add the new row or new second row to the third row and totally remove the third row. The third row becomes all 0. Then we finally get the row into the form. Let me rewrite this formula. So this is plus 2 and this is multiplied by minus 3. So by using the first row to remove the all the entries below the first column, and then use the new second row to remove the third, we can find a reduced form of original matrix called the row enchelon form. And from this form, we can see that the rank of the matrix A is actually 2. The identity matrix I is like 1 in real number. Any vector or matrix multiplied by I remains unchanged. So A multiplied by I is equal to I multiplied by A equal to A. But in fact, I is a matrix, so it's called identity matrix. It's a diagonal matrix that all the diagonal entries are equal to 1. This is identity matrix. So you can try to multiply I with a vector V, right? So the 3x3 identity matrix multiplied by the vector 2, 3, 4 is equal to itself, to the vector V itself. This is identity matrix. After defining the identity matrix, we can define the inverse of a matrix. The definition is that the product of a square matrix, or not that this is a square matrix, which means the number of rows is equal to the number of colors. And its inverse matrix, A minus 1, we use A minus 1 to represent the inverse of a matrix, produce the identity matrix. So matrix A multiplied by its own inverse, A minus 1, is equal to I. So A inverse is equal to A inverse multiplied by A is equal to identity matrix. An inverse matrix is square. So an inverse matrix is a square matrix, but not all square matrix has inverses. Now we know that a matrix must be a square matrix to have an inverse matrix. How about non-square matrix? To calculate the inverse of a non-square, we can use a method called the pseudo inverse function. So non-square matrix can still have left inverse or right inverse matrix. Okay, the trick is to first make a non-square matrix a square matrix. Here's an example how to use pseudo inverse to solve a linear equation. Okay, suppose we want to solve this equation, or want to calculate x. So the equation is ax is equal to b, right? So we first want to create a square matrix. So we multiply both sides with the A transpose. So after A transpose multiplied by A, it becomes a square matrix. Why? Suppose A is a n by n matrix, then A transpose is a n by n matrix, then A transpose multiplied by A becomes a n by n square matrix. So now we have a square matrix, we can use the inverse of the matrix, the inverse of the A transpose A. So the solution of x, of vector x, is actually A transpose A, the inverse matrix of A transpose multiplied by A multiplied by A transpose and multiplied by B. And the least This term is called the pseudo-inverse function. Let's look at more spatial vectors and matrices. The first is symmetric matrix. A symmetric matrix is that the entry aij is equal to entry aji. So the symmetric matrix A is actually equal to its own transpose, because transpose is to switch aji with aij, right? And in symmetric matrix aji is equal to aji. So for a symmetric matrix, it is equal to its own transpose. The second vector is called a unit vector. A unit vector's magnitude, or you can say length, is equal to 1. Or we can say that the LO2 norm of a unit vector is equal to 1. So the magnitude of unit vector is 1. Okay, the third property is very important. If vector x and y, we can call them, they are orthogonal if x transpose multiplied by y is equal to 0. Okay. Moreover, if the magnitude of x and y are both 1, then we can call those two vectors are orthonormal. The term x transpose multiplied by y equals 0 implies that x and y are orthogonal. Here is an example. We know that the inner product, right? This term is equal to inner product. The inner product of x vector x and vector y is equal to the product of their magnitude multiplied by cosine theta. And the theta 90, the 90 degree is 0. So if the inner product of vector x and the vector y is 0, then it implies that they are orthogonal. X and y are vertical. Now let's look at orthogonal matrix. A square matrix whose rows and columns are mutually orthogonal, If a square matrix whose rows and columns are mutually orthonormal, then it's called orthogonal matrix. And this implies that A transpose multiplied by A or A multiplied by A transpose is equal to identity matrix. This is because each row vector are mutually orthogonal. So the row vectors multiplied by the column vectors are orthogonal, right? Orthogonal. So they are equal to 0 except the multiplication or the diagonal, right? Because the diagonal, they are unit vectors, so the diagonal are 1. So the product of orthogonal matrix and its own transpose is equal to identity matrix. And then we can revert. We can derive that A inverse is actually equal to A transpose. So this is why we are very interested in the orthogonal matrix, because calculate the inverse matrix is very easy. It's just the transpose of the original matrix. Another important concept is norm. Norm is a measure of a vector's magnitude. So we can use norm to calculate the magnitude of vector or matrix. It's very important in machine learning because we always want to calculate the magnitude, right? The value of our loss function or our data. So we want to calculate the norm. Okay, the definition of norm is here. So we can have different kind of norms. So we can call it LP. LP has a special meaning in Taiwanese. So LP norm, P is a variable. If P equals 2, then it's called L2 norm. L2 norm is the most common norm. Right? It's actually the sum of the square of the entries. Right? And then calculate the root. So it's the root of the sum of the squares of entries. Okay, so it's L2 norm. Another very common norm is L1 norm. L1 norm is actually the sum of the absolute value of the entries in a vector. This is L1 norm. Another special kind of norm is L-infinity norm. It's very interesting. Infinity is to let the variable p approach infinity, and this equals the max number in a vector. So L-infinity norm is actually find the max number, the max entry in a vector. Here's a picture show the difference between L1 norm and L2 norm in geometry. Suppose we have a 2D vector and its value is x1 and x2. If we use L2 norm to calculate the difference or to calculate the magnitude, it will be equal to the longest edge, right, in a triangle. Okay, so this is the L2 norm. L1 norm is actually the sum of the other two edges, right? So the L1 norm is here, is the absolute value of x1 and x2, and in geometry is equal to sum of these two sides of a triangle. Here is the formal definition of a norm. Any function f which meets the three criteria can be a norm function. The first definition is the triangular inequality. So the f of x plus y is less or equal to f of x plus f of y. This is called the triangular inequality. The sum of the two sides of a triangle is larger or equal to the other side. The second criteria is absolute homogeneity. So if the constant or scalar alpha is in the norm function f of alpha x, then it can become the alpha or the absolute alpha multiplied by f of x for all real number. The third criteria is the positive definiteness. Okay, so if the f of x equals 0, then x equals 0. Any function that meets the three criteria can be a norm function. Eigenvector is another important concept in linear algebra. The prefix eigen is adopted from German word, which means characteristic. So eigenvector is also called characteristic vector. Okay, the definition of eigenvector is here. Eigenvector is a non-zero vector that's changed by only a scalar factor lambda with linear transformation A. So here's the formula. Ax is equal to lambda x. So here's a picture that describes the behavior of eigenvector. So if x is an eigenvector, then if we apply the linear transformation A, or matrix A to the eigenvector, then the eigenvector, we just change the magnitude of the vector, but not the direction. Okay, in this case, x is called eigenvector and the lambda is called eigenvalue of matrix A. It's very important, it has a wide range of applications in many different fields. In machine learning, the most important algorithm is called principal component analysis, PCA, or you can apply it on graph and calculate the eigenvector centrality or even the page rank. So eigenvector and the value is a very good example of how to apply linear algebra in machine learning. How can we calculate the eigenvector and eigenvalue? There is one approach called characteristic polynomial. So from definition, we will have AV equals lambda V. V is our target eigenvector. And we can move the lambda V to the left side, right? So that will become an A minus lambda I identity matrix multiplied by vector V. Because eigenvector cannot be zero, so this implies that A minus lambda I is not invertible. If A minus lambda I is not invertible, this implies that the determinant of A minus lambda I is zero. So we can use this property to calculate the characteristic polynomial. Okay, so suppose we have a matrix A here, and the characteristic polynomial is A minus lambda I, and lambda is a variable that we want to find solution. So this new characteristic matrix can becomes this one, and then we can calculate the variant. To calculate the variant, we first calculate multiply 2 minus lambda by 2 minus lambda. So in other words, we multiply A11 by A22. And then we multiply A12 by A21 and the minus 1, which will be equal to 3 minus 4 lambda plus lambda squared. So we can solve this polynomial and get the lambda 1 two solutions. First is the lambda 1 equals 1 and the lambda 2 equals 3. And use those two values. So we got two eigenvalue, and we can use replace the lambda with the eigenvalue and then find two eigenvectors. Okay, the eigenvector for lambda equals 1 is 1 minus 1, and the eigenvector of lambda equals 3 is 1, 1. So there are two eigenvectors in this of the transformation matrix A. Another approach for computing eigenvector is called power iteration method. This method is more suitable for computers because it's very difficult for computers to solve the characteristic polynomial. So here are the steps. First, we start with random vector V, and then we do it again and again, calculate iteratively. Just keep multiply the transformation matrix A to the original random vector V, and we continue to doing this until Vk converges, which means the V to the power of k plus 1 is similar, almost the same as the V to the power of k. So in other words, the Vk doesn't change. This formula is equal to ak, right, the v to the power of k plus 1 is ak multiplied by v equal to vk, which is a to the power of k minus 1 multiplied k multiplied by v. And this formula is equal to a plus this a to the power of k minus 1 multiplied by v is actually vk, right? So this implies that a multiplied by vk equals to vk. Okay, so as we can see, a multiplied by vk, okay, we still better use approximate. It's very close to vk, so it's not changed or only have slightly changed. In this case, the v to the power of k will be the eigenvector with largest eigenvalue. The eigenvector can also be applied in image processing. Here is an example. It's called shear mapping. Okay, if we can try to transform our image into different shape, right? The shear mapping is just change the direction of one axis of the image. So in this case, the vertical, there are two axes, right? It's a vertical axis, the y-axis, and the horizontal axis, x-axis. After the shear transform, shear mapping, the direction of the vertical axis changed, but the horizontal axis is not changed. So the horizontal axis is the eigenvector. The transformation matrix A is here. So you can see there's a, it is an identity matrix plus shear parameters K, right? So its characteristic polynomial is lambda minus 1 squared. And the eigenvector is actually 1, 0, is actually the x-axis. Here's the eigenvalues of the most popular geometric transformations. This table is from Wikipedia. So let's see. The first one is scaling, right? So scale the shape. So it's just multiply k to the identity matrix. So the eigenvalues are k, right? And the second one is unequal scaling. So we have different scaling factors for different entries on the diagonal. So the eigenvalues are now k1 and k2. We have two eigenvalues. And here's the characteristic polynomial. The third one is the rotation matrix. In this case, C is the cosine theta and the sine is, S is sine theta. So it's cosine, cosine, sine, minus sine. Okay, so the eigenvalue is more complicated. It's a complex number. And here's a polynomial. Okay, the fourth one is the shear transform we have just introduced in last page. So here's the matrix. The eigenvalues are both 1, so only one eigenvalue. The last one is the hyperbolic rotation. So it's a cosine, hyperbolic cosine, okay, and the hyperbolic sine. Otherwise, it's similar to the rotation matrix. We can decompose a matrix into multiple eigenvectors. This is called eigen decomposition. So let A be a square matrix. Note, we can only do eigen decomposition for square matrix. So for square matrix, n by n matrix, with n linearly independent eigenvectors, so it need to be four rank, then A can be factorized as A equals Q lambda Q inverse, where Q is the square n by n matrix, where I column is the eigenvector of Qi of A, and lambda is the diagonal matrix whose diagonal elements are the eigenvalues lambda ii equals lambda I. So we can decompose a square matrix A into the eigenvector matrix Q, n by n matrix Q, and multiply by a diagonal matrix whose diagonal elements are all the eigenvalues for, and multiplied by the Q inverse. This is eigen decomposition. Well, let's try to calculate eigen decomposition. From the definition, we first remove the Q and the Q inverse in the original term. So we multiplied the Q inverse at the left side and multiply Q at the right side. So we have a new term, Q inverse multiplied by A matrix multiplied by Q. So let's see an example. Suppose here's the matrix A. Then we want to calculate the eigenvector, so we have four variables A, B, C, D in the Q matrix. And then we also want to calculate, we want to find the eigenvectors. We let the variable X and Y. So we can try to solve this equation. Because of the time, we omit the details. You can refer to the original examples in the Wikipedia. Eigen decomposition has one problem. It can only be applied to square matrix. But most matrix are not squared, so we need a more general decomposition method. That is the singular value decomposition, SVD. So the SVD can factorize a non-square matrix into singular vectors and singular values. So in eigen decomposition, the vectors are called eigenvectors, but here in SVD, it's called singular vectors and singular values. Good news is that every real matrix has a SVD. So here is here's a picture from Wikipedia. Suppose we have a m by n matrix, non-square. We can decompose it into three matrix. The first one is m by n square matrix. The second is a m by n diagonal matrix, And the third is a V transpose. V matrix V is a n by n matrix. So the SVD can decompose a matrix into three matrix. Here is another notation. So matrix A can be decomposed into matrix U multiplied by diagonal matrix D and V transpose, matrix V transpose. Both matrix U and the matrix V are orthogonal matrix, which implies that the U multiplied by its own transpose equals identity matrix M, same as matrix V, or V multiplied by V transpose is equal to identity matrix N. Again, we can use SVD for recommender system. As mentioned before, we can use a matrix to record the preference of the products. So the rows are the users and the columns are the products. Here are books. And we can use a matrix to record that how many stars a user give to a book. For example, in this case, the first user give 4 stars to book 1 and 3 stars to book 2. So we want to predict how many stars the first user will give to book 4, right? So we can use SPD to decompose the matrix into two vectors, to a orthogonal matrix, matrix U and the matrix V. So the matrix U is a N by K matrix and the matrix V is a K by M matrix. But here is a problem. How can we design the dimension K? How do we know to choose the right K? The answer is this is an empirical number. We assume that there is a latent feature, which means it's not directly observable. Latent feature K, right? So we hope there is a hidden space, k-dimensional space, and we can use k to represent the user features. Also, we can represent the book features, right? So the k book feature and the user features. And once we multiply the user feature with the book feature, and we can automatically, we can calculate the scores of the unknown book, right? Because the K represents the user feature, which maybe contains the information like the gender or the age or her favorite books. So we hope those features are embedded in the K feature, and also the K vector can represent the book, and by decompose and then remultiply those two vectors, we remove the diagonal matrix, right? And reconstruct the we factorize the original matrix and reconstruct the new matrix, and hope the score can predict the preference of the user. Principal Component Analysis, PCA, is one of the most famous algorithms in machine learning. It's based on eigenvectors. So it's a good example of how to apply linear algebra algorithm to machine learning. So the goal of Principal Component Analysis is to find the important, principal means important, find the important axis, which means component. Here's a figure shows the principal component, shows the idea of PCA. First, there are 2D data, right? So we want to find the most important axis. In this case, this vector in this direction has highest variance. So it can be a principal component. If we instead use only this vector, we project the points to this vector and use the projected data point to represent data, then we can do dimensionality reduction. So usually in machine learning, we use PCA for dimensionality reduction. So it belongs to unsupervised learning. Okay, so there are some key assumptions of PCA. First is the linearity. It assumes that the data are linear. The second assumption is that the mean and the variance are sufficient statistics, which means that we can use variance, the axis with largest variance to represent the data. Okay. And the last assumption is the most important. The principal components assume that all the principal components are orthogonal. So here they are orthogonal, right? Those two axes are orthogonal. We can use PCA find to axis, the first axis and the second axis right here. Those two axes are principal component. One of the most famous application of PCA is face recognition. So here are some examples. Suppose we have a small data set. This data set include the former US President Bush and the former Prime Minister of United Kingdom, Tony Blair, or other many celebrities or politicians. And we can use the PCA right to project the face to principal components. Because the pixel or the number of pixels are very large, so it's create a high dimension. Although those images are grayscale and not clear, low resolution. But at that time, it was being proposed decades ago. At that time, it was very difficult. The computing power was very low, so it's hard to recognize. It's hard to process high dimension data. Of course, in from today's standard, those are very small data set, very small. And so the researchers proposed to use PCA and then project the face data into the principal components. So it's first use PCA to find the principal components and then project the data to the components. So the face that project to the component can show some features of the original face, right? So we can use the component as the new dimension. So we have done a dimensionality reduction for face. Those faces are called eigenface. Those eigenface are the projection on different principles. Okay. And once we have the eigenface, we can use a classification algorithm to classify the face of different people. So it's eigenface plus the SVM. This is the one of the most famous application of PCA in machine learning. Now let's see how to calculate linear algebra using Python. There is a wonderful package called NumPy. NumPy is a fundamental package for scientific computing with Python. Why? Because it supports all the tensor operations. So it has a powerful n-dimensional array object. And it can automatically, it's called broadcasting, but it can expand or copy the low dimension vector into higher dimension. It's called broadcasting in short. So it's a very good tool to do linear algebra. And the tool not only made by Python, it has integrate C and C++ and even Fortran code. So it's highly efficient. That's why almost all the frameworks select Python as its underlying language. I believe it's one of the reasons because it supports a very it has a very good scientific package like NumPy and more. Of course, the simplicity of Python is one of the reasons. So it's very useful for linear algebra and other scientific computing like Fourier transform and the random number capabilities. So, let me show you how to use NumPy to create tensors. Okay, the first is to create a scalar. First, we import the NumPy package. So we import NumPy and give it an alias as np. And we can create a NumPy array, np.array, and assign the real number that we want, so it's 12. So we have a variable, a scalar variable, which the value is 12. We can print it, or just input the name of the variable, and Python will automatically print what's inside. So it's a print and it's array 12. To check if it's a really a scalar, we can print the number of dimension. It's called n dimension in NumPy package. So we print n dimension and it's 0. So we have create a scalar. So how to create a vector? A vector is actually to pass a Python array into the NP array, right, NumPy array. So we create a vector with 4 data, 4 elements. And we can print x, and now it's print array and the 4 element. Let's check the dimension, n dimension is 1. So now we have a 1D tensor, we have a vector. So how to create a matrix? Right, how to create a matrix? Matrix 2D, so we first list all the row, right? All the row together. And then we we start with the row vectors and then we add additional square bracket. We add 2 square bracket here, which means it's a 2-dimensional tensor, right? 2 square bracket. And now we can check the number of dimension, right? Now it's 2, so we have create a matrix. Follow previous rules. We can add more square bracket right here to create a higher dimensional tensor. So here's an example of create a 3-dimensional tensor, 3D tensor. So we first add 3 rows and then add a bracket, a pair of brackets. Then 3 rows, a pair of brackets, and 3 rows and a pair of bracket, and then and additional pair of square bracket. Here are some important attributes of a NumPy tensor. First, the number of axes, or is also called dimensions or called rank. As we mentioned before, dimensions sometimes confused because there's a vector dimension and tensor dimension. So it's better called axes or rank. Okay, the variable is n DIM, n dimension. Another important attribute is shape. It's a tuple of integers. Show how many data the tensor has along each axis. So you can just print x dot shape, and it will print all the number of data along each axis. This is a very useful feature, very useful attribute. Okay, the next is the data type. So there are 3 data types: the on-site NTA, float, floating point, 32-bit or 64-bit floating point. So you can design the data type of the NumPy tensor. Let's see how to perform matrix multiplication using NumPy. So first import NumPy as np and then create a matrix. Let's use the example shown earlier. First create a matrix x which elements are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Right? It's a 2x3 matrix. And then we create a 3x2 matrix. Why? Data are 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So this is the same as the example introduced before. And then we call the function matrix multiplication, or it's called matmult, M-A-T-M-U-L, and then pass the 2 matrix. And this is the final result, which is the same as our answer. So use NumPy, we can do the matrix multiplication easily. So it's very convenient and a powerful package. We will see a lot of tensor multiplications in deep learning. So why are we doing so many transformation, linear transform, like the matrix multiplication or dimensionality reduction in deep learning or in machine learning? The reason is that we want to unfold the manifold. The manifold is a topological space that locally resembles Euclidean space. So the tensor operations like the multiplication, addition, or subtraction are complex geometric transformation in high-dimensional data space. So in other words, we want to reduce the complex dimension into lower dimension and then apply algorithms to do the recognition or prediction. Here's a good metaphor. Unfolding the manifold is just like to unfold a paper ball, the paper ball into the original paper. So after unfolding the complex manifold, we got a simple, for example, plane, right? So we can easily apply our algorithms on this plane. That's why we do a lot of transformation.